The potential of resources of the pre-salt are massive, prolific. We have seen that these three companies are pretty much committed to the pre-salt, and there are several challenges that have been pointed out here, and it's a great opportunity for this audience to start a dialogue with them to improve your knowledge on the pre-salt. So I would like to ask if there is any question that you'd like to. Okay, I have Carlos Arends from Galway and Werge.
Thank you very much for the presentation. I have just one question. Just now you mentioned the thing of gas. Producing oil out there 300 kilometers away from shore, you have the FPSOs. But what about the natural gas? How much of that will your companies think it will reach the shore? Because this seminar has begun yesterday with the talk of Mr. Paul Pedroza talking about Gaspar Institute. And there is this position of Petrobras reducing its participation in the natural gas market. So, to make things run, somebody else's apart from Bolivian gas and from LNG should be offering more gas. And this expectation is stated in one of the groups of the Gaspar Crescer about the natural gas from the pre-salt. What would be your expectation, what would be your perspectives on this natural gas reaching ashore and filling up some part of the role that Petrobras is saying is going to withdraw?
Who wants to start?
That's a $1 million question, and it's not an easy answer, but let me try to elaborate maybe two or three points on this. First of all, we are in the early days of a transition here in the gas market in Brazil. If we look back the last 10 years, a lot has been said and very few actions that were taken related to the changing in the regulatory framework of gas. So let's hope now it's different, and I think it will be different fundamentally because of the divestment program of Petrobras. So that's point number one. Point number two, currently those two projects that we have in São Paulo, they are in very early stages. We haven't ruled out any field development concept, so everything is being studied. And then of course you can have a floating LNG out there, you can lay out a pipeline of 250 kilometers to shore. When you are the beachhead, you can put in the grid, or you can have an industrial consumer or a thermal power plant. So none of the field development concepts are completely ruled out, especially because we don't have the certainty or we don't have the clarity of the gas regulatory framework. My third and last point is that it's not going to be easy. The first company to be able to provide significant volumes to the Brazilian market, apart from Petrobras, will have an advantage but will also pay a price. So we have to balance those uncertainties. These projects are not a walk in the park. These are complex projects. BMC-33 is on the limit of the approved technology for some of the subsidiaries. We're talking about 3,000 liters of water depth only. I think the only project that we have at that depth or close to this is a Shell project in Gulf of Mexico. So these things are not going to be cheap. So let's not create an expectation in the society that this gas will come extremely cheap to the beachhead or to the shore, because they won't. And if you don't have the appropriate incentives for the upstream players to monetize those gas, those projects are not going to fly. Or they will start producing liquids before, and then later down the road you start the gas production. So those are the three points that I want to make a consideration. I don't think this is an answer, but it's a consideration for all of us to make.
Is there anyone who wants to add something?
Okay. To a gas, to need gas, you need a market. So the gas in Brazil is being talked and should be seen with two heads. As the one hand is, of course, the gas upstream and everything what Mauro said about gas deep offshore is not cheap and not easy. But to have gas, you need to have a market. You need to call for gas so that it works. And I believe it's also another side of the gas pipe, as I said, certainly as important as having the gas as resources in Brazil.
Okay. Is there another question? Because I have one question, maybe. Okay, proceed.
Gareth Checkman with Upstream Oil and Gas Research. Mario was showing some of the areas of progress that Brazil has been making on areas like single operator and local content, but we've also showed that there are still complexities and uncertainties. I just wanted to ask some comments on a couple of the uncertainties. One, the proposed taxes by the state of Rio on the ICMS on production and the national taxes, and also the continuing uncertainty with environmental permitting. I wanted to just ask how serious are these in terms of obstacles to future investments and resource balance and licensing?
Okay, you are free to...
environmental licensing as well. I believe it's somehow a brainer. If you cannot drill, you cannot find oil. So I believe it's very important. What I can see, I see a lot of effort for all stakeholders, Ministry of Environment, Ministry of Oil, ANP, and the companies to try to find the right solution to accelerate the way we reach the point where the companies are paying licenses. It's a matter of predictability. You want, as an investor, to be able to predict. The rest of it, it's also a matter of Brazilian sovereignty. It's a Brazilian sovereign state. What I can note is that there's a kind of excellency in the people who are the technicians who are working on the license. In Brazil, it's an advantage. You know that when you've got a license, it's rubbish. Because the people that grant you that license, they know what they are talking about. The aspect we need to tackle is the predictability in terms of timing. And indeed, if you have no predictability, it might impact the way you are preparing your investment.
It sounds like
we
try to complicate things more than they are. I think when you look at a project, we sometimes define that you have technical risks and opportunities, as there are as well non-technical risks and opportunities. And I think it's about dialogue, it's about collaboration to make things happen in a tough business environment, either from a technical standpoint or from a non-technical standpoint. And I think that's what we are encouraged about. Is there are signs of optimism, so things can be done. But as I think I like your slide, it's not very easy, it's hard, tough, there'll be blood. It's just not here. As it is not here for developing a gas market. But I think what you do, and I think Brazil has done, and Petrobras has done for the last at least 16 years, you can see the benefit of that hard work. So I think with hard work, with dialogue and collaboration, hopefully, all those technical and non-technical risks in 15 years from now will just be a good ahead of us.
The easiest answer to you would be to say that yes, this is devastating. With the negative taxes or changes in legislation in general are devastating to us, and then they will make our lives boom and gloom, but let's put it in perspective. There are changes in other countries in the world that our companies operate, even in the UK or in Norway. The difference years, the magnitude of the changes and the speed of changes, they occur on a different dimension. And when it's extremely different impact on your net present value or on your bottom line when your product is already produced and you have already cashed in some of the same things to implement a change, then when you are at the early stages of development, before the decision making process or sanction the project is made. So that is an extremely difficult point for us. All of us, we have projects in Brazil that are in early stages. So yes, losing the effects makes things extremely difficult. Yes, they do make. But they make especially because we are in this decision making process. We operate in countries where the overall government age is probably higher than Brazil. And our companies made a choice to operate in this place, but we knew the rules of the game before the game starts. So it's actually the predictability that it really makes our lives difficult. Of course, when you add the complexity of the projects that we're trying to develop in Brazil, with water, borderline of technological solutions, etc., then you add more uncertainty. Any above ground risks that we can mitigate in this process is extremely interesting for our decision makers to be more comfortable with that. And again, we are no longer in 2012 and 13. Statoil today has less than half of the capex to invest on a yearly basis than it had 3-4 years ago. So it's simply prioritization of moving forward. If something else elsewhere in the world is better, then I'll probably go for it. Something else in the world.
Okay, I have a question about these numbers that you have been presenting. All of you have presented numbers showing the increase in productivity and cost reduction in a very short period of time. And more or less a year ago, we had a seminar at IBP regarding the costs of the oil industry in Brazil, and mainly in the pre-salt. And there we have been presenting a paper where we have shown that the unconventional ability to reduce costs were higher than the deep offshore. And these numbers came from the Department of Energy in the US, where they compared unconventionals with deep offshore, Gulf of Mexico, deep offshore. But 1 year later, what we see is that they took a picture of the ability of the offshore to reduce costs and increase productivity at that time, because the movie goes slowly in deep offshore than in the unconventional. So my question is, given the fact that you have been successful to reduce very fast the costs, how you see the competitiveness of the main assets in deep offshore, like the pre-salt, as compared to the unconventional? Is there still room to keep going in this trajectory of cost reduction in the sense that that will bring deep offshore assets in a very good position to compare with good assets in terms of unconventional in the US? How do you see this potential?
I think sky is the limit. So I think trying to put ourselves a
target, I think it's, you may have a target for the month, a target for the quarter, but I think innovation, by definition, doesn't have a target. I think creativity of our engineers, of our people is, as I said, sky is the limit. So, and I think what we have learned, and I will welcome their views as well over the last sort of 2-3 years, is that we knew things that we didn't know. We didn't know how capable of doing things as we did. And I think that gave us confidence that there is still more to be done. The journey on doing things better, more efficiently, and safely, that journey has not stopped. Where's the limit? I don't know. But I think the ambition and the aspiration, based on the track record that we as an industry, and this is just not us, it's contractors, it's people working with us, it's collaboration, it has shown us that the price is still big and there is much more than we can do and achieve. But I think, as I think was said earlier, this is something that is not only about us, I think it's about the whole stakeholder community mm-hmm. that needs to improve in that journey to make our business much more competitive as we face new challenges.
Okay.
Yes, just to add, because we like to talk. No, just to build on what Helman said, it's a matter of having a reliable and responsive ecosystem. I believe that what DeepUp has shown is that it is exactly that, a very responsive and reliable ecosystem. So I agree with you, sky is the limit. The government is also part of this ecosystem. So this kind of event is very important to exchange, to challenge ourselves, and to stimulate the ecosystem, and to have the government to be part of it, and to be responsive as well to make it progressing in the right direction.
Okay. So, with that, is there any other question? Yes.
Thank you. Rodolfo Taigi, Technip FMC. Very good presentations, very good topic. Pre-salt and innovation, technology, going deeper. In your organizations, have you seen a change as well on the way the projects are being sanctioned? I mean, decision gates, the traditional way of evaluating projects in the past, when we had 100 barrels plus oil, now we have half, and everything should be half the cost, half the for the project to be feasible and be sanctioned, everything should be cut in half. But the process within your organization, are you seeing a change, an improvement of making it faster, having pre-engagement with the supply chain, earlier phases, to bring new solutions to enable the half of the cost, and enable the projects at the end to be sanctioned with the current scenario of 50 barrels, $50 a barrel. This is for the three of you, German, yeah, Maxim, no. and Mauro.
Thanks for the question. But just building before, I think you said sky is the limit, and I think it was Einstein's definition that sort of definition of insanity is trying to get a different outcome by still keep doing the same thing. So I think we are reinventing ourselves. I think we are challenging ourselves on everything we do, because trying to expect that by keep doing the same, we're going to just reduce cost by 50%, it just doesn't happen. So I think it's about our day-to-day challenge on everything we do safely, on every process, on every design, on do we really need that? And I think sometimes we engineers, we like stuff, yeah? And we like gadgets, but then we pay a price for those gadgets. The question is, do you really need that gadget for what you want to achieve? And more important, can you afford that gadget? And then are there other ways that you can achieve the same thing by a different way? And that brings collaboration, which is, I may have an answer, but he may have another answer. Maybe his answer helps me. So I think we are really looking at ourselves with a much more humble approach, that we may now know everything, and that we need to challenge ourselves to try to have new approaches, new things, not undermining standards, not undermining technical integrity, not undermining safety. But I think that is part of the game.
Yeah, I think this is a very good question. First of all, Yes, we have changed the criteria on how we sanction projects in Statoil. So, and I think my peers will echo me. We're no longer looking for volume, we're looking for value, first of all. Secondly, yes, early phase involvement with the supply chain is absolutely key to have new ideas, and as German said, you know, sky's the limit when you do properly an engagement in the early phase development. When it comes to the process, this is very internal, but one thing I can share with you, in Statoil we have decision gate, from decision gate 0 to decision gate 4, which is first oil. Our decision gate 1, which used to be to prove one feasible concept to develop a field, it has now become much more stringent. So my DG1 is now requires a much more robust business case to move forward, to avoid changing concepts between DG1 and the sanction. That reduces costs a lot. And finally, when it comes to engineering, I mean, I always like to use the example that GE gave to many of you, maybe 2 years ago, 1.5 years ago in GE Center, when they came here and say, a typical turbine used in a power module in an FPSO for the oil and gas industry has 400% more engineering hours than the same turbine that goes into an airplane, which is, by the way, 95% similar. So why the hell we have 400% more engineering hours on a turbine for? And I think it goes with what you said, you know, it's gadgets, it's here and there, it's everything is tailor-made, nothing is standardized, nothing is... I have a concrete example in Peregrino. You know, we have drilled 45 wells in the Peregrino reservoir now. At some point in time, we've looked at one tool in the well that cost $1 million each, which is geo steering tool. I've looked to my people, my Petec people, and say, guys, after drilling 40 wells in this reservoir, if you don't know what you're doing and you need this geo steering tool, something is really wrong. So take this out. Run the risk of drilling without this. So this is, you know, just adding extra and extra and extra. And yet, we have to do it without compromising safety. So it is a fine balance, but it's doable, because if it was not doable, we wouldn't be able to reduce the costs as we showed to you here. So it's an everyday battle. We have to change the mindset of our people.
So if there is no other question, I think we are about to end this session. We have promised German that he would be able to fly back to Barra da Tijuca at 5:30. And it was a very, very interesting session.
We can afford an helicopter, so...
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. I thought... Well, and it has been a very interesting session. We've seen that there are many things going on at the pre-salt in terms of innovation, learning, in order to reduce costs of huge projects, to adapt these projects to the new context of the industry. So this is not something easy to do. It's not something that they can do in a week. It's a lot of work and a lot of courage too, because imagine it's like maneuvering transatlantic in a very thin river. Any wrong maneuver, it's very dangerous. And still we have a government and politics playing a role, a very important role. We didn't discuss a lot about this year, but we would need a specific seminar for that. And even if we expand this an effort to discuss what's going on in politics in Brazil, we wouldn't come to a conclusion which would be useful for this kind of purpose. The situation is so complex that I think that it's better to focus on what they are doing to see what they can do to improve the productivity, to reduce costs, of course, and also dealing with the government to see what we can do with the rules, you know, at least to have rules that can be stable in order to allow companies to work on this challenge, which is to make pre-salt competitive in this new price environment. But I think that I'm very optimistic. Of course, it's not my money that I'm putting is going there, but by seeing this movie here and as an oil analyst and by the field that I know about Brazilian politics, I think that we can be optimistic. What has been already done with the pre-salt proves that the sky is the limit, because in very few years we have been able to make a very important change in the Brazilian oil landscape. And even with the crisis after 2014, pre-salt remain is a very, very important play, not only in Brazil, but worldwide, being able to grow. And it's thanks to the efforts of companies like those that are represented here today. So with that, I would like to end this session, and I would like to ask you to help me to applaud our guest today, who spent a few hours of their day with us. It's an honor for us. Thank you very much for coming and exchange IG with us.
Obrigado,
Marco.
Obrigado,
né?
Obrigado.
Desculpa pela pergunta. Obrigado pela resposta.
Eu queria te apresentar uma pessoa.
Eu tenho um número para você. O Giovanni Machado falou outro dia.